So welcome, rocket fans, back to the Copenhagen Suborbitals rocket shop and our current affairs. I'm standing here with Thomas Petersen, our flight, and he'll be taking us through many of the different projects we have currently going on. So Thomas, we announced a Spica rocket lately after the next two launch. Spica rocket, this giant rocket that's going to take our astronaut to the edge of space, beyond, and back home again. And it's a monster rocket, and it means that a lot of new initiatives needed to be started. One of the things that we actually also have ongoing right now, and I think the development is actually pretty much done, and we're just fabrication left, but that's the biggest water flow test stand that CS has ever done and is probably ever going to do.
Yeah.
So what's with this one?
So once we get these swirlers characterized and we settle on a design, then for the BPM-100 engine, we'll build a complete injector.
With how many elements?
So tentatively 130.
Okay.
So, but they're easy to manufacture and they're made by CNC lathe operation, so it's pretty simple. So we'll build a full injector with around 130 of these swirlers, and then we will have to subject that to a flow test to see that everything performs normally. So for that, we're making the largest water flow test system we have ever conceived. So it consists of four big tanks, two of which are for water and two of which are for pressure and gas.
Mm.
And so we will flow around 50 liters per second. So a 10-second test is 500 kilos of water. So it's for our standards, it's pretty massive amounts of water to flow. So the setup is just big.
Yeah. So more or less the same thing. I guess it's part of the speaker effect on CS and what else has been going on, because we use some of the same principles, but again on a whole new level, because everything just gets so much bigger.
So, yeah.
And the water flow test stand is also going to help. I heard something about 3-inch pipes on fuel and LOX side, so it's massive amounts of water.
It will have 3-inch pipes, and so will the speaker rocket, presumably.
Mm-hmm.
To reduce pressure loss, we simply have to go up in 3-inch piping for the propellants. If we go down to 2-inch, then there's a pressure drop of around, I think it's half a bar per running meter. Which is just too much pressure to lose.
Yeah, it was just it's sort of an odd thought that an engine which has two-inch pipes in parallel is going to get choked because it can't get enough fuel.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we'll get to that. It's going to be awesome. One of the other things that we had to look deep into was also the pressurization scheme of the speaker rocket, because back on the Nexo class rockets, we use this DPR, the dynamic pressure regulation system, which basically supplements helium into the two propellant tanks as we consume the fuel from the bottom. Yeah. So the basic idea is to keep the tank pressures and maintain the tank pressures constant throughout the flight. That means we also get a consistent engine performance, full throttle, until we run dry. Mm. How was that done on the Nexo class rockets? I mean, the gas tank.
On Nexo rockets, it was, or Nexo 2 in particular, it was pretty simple. We had a high pressure bottle, 20 liters, of 300 bar helium. And that was just supplied to the propellant tanks. The helium was supplied to the propellant tanks to maintain high pressure of around 20 bars, 21 bars. And so, in principle, we could do the same on Spica. However, the helium tank that we would need would be fairly large, and it's quite difficult to obtain large high pressure vessels, so we could go with about 10 tanks of the same type as we used.
Yeah, I mean, they're a little bit special because they're like these lightweight thin aluminum liner and then carbon fiber wrapped on the outside, so it's really a carbon fiber reinforced high pressure lightweight tank.
Yeah, it is. And so I think for speaker, we'll need 10 or 12 of those. And they're quite expensive. And it's sort of a mess to fit all those tanks into the speaker rocket. So we're going with something that's a lot smaller, but technically more challenging. And so the idea is to bring the pressurant as a liquid. So instead of bringing helium gas, we bring a liquid. And so bring liquid helium would be prohibitively expensive. So we are going with liquid helium. sorry, liquid nitrogen.
Yeah, liquid nitrogen. I recall we did. We actually tried it out with pressurizing gaseous nitrogen a year or 2 years back on the engine test stand, and at that point, at least, we validated that it seemed to work fine. But again, so the not bringing nitrogen in gas but in liquid form. So yes, we save the we save all those high pressure bottles for gas. But what's the deal then with turning liquid nitrogen into gaseous nitrogen?
So the problem is that we have in the propellant tanks we have a volume that we simply need to fill up with a pressured gas as you deplete the propellant. And so
it's like 40 or 60,000 standard liters of nitrogen. It's a huge amount.
It's about 60,000 standard liters that we need to have, and so we can bring that as liquid nitrogen, and then of course we will need to gasify it, evaporate it, and we could stop there. We would simply just evaporate it and lead the evaporated nitrogen into the tanks and pressurize with that. But we're opting to go a little bit further to reduce the amount of nitrogen even more. So we are going to heat the nitrogen. So we're going to tentatively heating it to about 200 degrees, 300 maybe. And so that moves the scales a lot because then we don't need very much nitrogen.
So we as far as I understand like it, I mean, for heating it from room temperature to maybe 300 degrees Celsius, that cuts the mass of liquid nitrogen we need to bring by like half or so?
Roughly half, yeah.
Okay.
So so we're going to end up with having something like 30 kilos of liquid nitrogen on board, and then we'll evaporate it and we'll heat it. And to do that, so you could do that by having it run through some sort of heat exchanger on the engine. So on the BP100 engine, there would be plenty of heat available to do that job. But to run this this nitrogen through a heat exchanger on the engine is a little bit complicated. I mean, it complicates the engine itself. So what we have chosen to opt for is to make a heat exchanger device on its own with its own burner.
Okay.
So the Spica rocket will basically have two rocket engines. It will have the main rocket engine that, of course, lifts it, and then it will have a significantly smaller rocket engine that will simply provide heat to the gasification of liquid nitrogen and to heat it. So we're bringing back an old project here. So we're bringing back some BPM2 hardware.
Yeah, that sounds interesting.
So BPM2 was this pre-engine before the BPM5. And so
I remember it as a very aggressive pipe.
It was very loud. So, but it's an engine that runs at a much lower fuel consumption, lower thrust, of course. And we're going to run it in a very fuel-rich state.
Why would one do that? That would give a lousy combustion.
Yes, but so we're not really looking for combustion here. We're looking for a lot of temperature. And so we also are looking for to make the design easy. So we'd like to keep the combustion temperature low so that we can build everything on the burner out of mild steel. And so if we keep the combustion temperature around 1000 Kelvin, then we can build all the components of it just from steel. To simply simplify everything.
So it's trying to avoid it, the whole thing melting down in case something goes wrong?
Yeah, exactly. So basically by limiting the combustion temperature to something like 1,000 degrees, it's very difficult to end up in a situation where it overheats and melts away. So and we do that simply by running it fuel rich. So we'll be running at a fuel OF ratio of about 0.5.
And the optimum is like 1.3, so it's way off.
I mean, from a propulsive point of view, it's way off, and it will maybe be soothing a bit, oozing out black soot. But but so we're in the process of designing that, and to really evaporate the nitrogen and to heat it up, we need something like half a megawatt of continuous power on this evaporator, and so it's essentially a BPM2 converted to have an even lower mass flow, fuel rich. And I think the propellant consumption on it is like 10 kilos per minute. So it's it's very low propellant
combined
consumption.
I mean, it's going to be run from alcohol and liquid oxygen that we already got on board.
That we already
so
have
10 kilograms in a minute or so.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
that's
it, and it will run for 50 seconds or so. So it's very small amounts of propellant that you need to run it.
Mm.
And then it will feed its gas into a heat exchanger. So we're designing this heat exchanger, which has, I believe it has 70 meters of pipe, where the which is sort of bundled together inside a small box.
I've seen the drawing. It's a maze. I mean, if the nitrogen comes out there and it's anything less than very confused, I would be surprised.
Yeah, it goes back and forth a lot of times in the heat exchanger. So it has about 70 meters of a feed line. And so the gas is simply fed into the heat exchanger, and then we hope that we'll get 300 degrees nitrogen gas.
It's still worth mentioning that this is still just a prototype setup.
That is the prototype, yes. So this is a prototype that we'll test on the ground. And first we'll test it by running water through the heat exchanger part of it. And then later on we'll run some nitrogen through it to validate that that we actually pressurize a vessel with the nitrogen that comes out.
Mm.
And so that's a very interesting project. So it's stepping up somewhat on complexity, because so controlling this burner, that adds complexity. So we opt to have the burner running at a steady propellant consumption rate,
mm-hmm.
and then we'll lead nitrogen through the and then we'll have to dose the liquid nitrogen that comes in to keep the pressure up in the main propellant tanks.
Mm.
And so there's some regulation coming into play with that. So it actually it involves a number of valves and a number of sensors. So it's
yeah, but I mean, we wouldn't do this unless there was a huge some gain to it somewhere.
Yes.
I remember a list of that was compiled of I think 20 or 30 different possible configurations of a DPR system for the Spica rocket. And at the worst end, I remember numbers like a total DPR system mass of 650 kilograms or so, which is completely unacceptable for a rocket that weighs 4 tons fully fueled.
Mm.
And then all the way down to something like 60 or 70 kilograms all in all. So this solution that we've gone with here, where does that end up on that scale?
So this system ends up in the lower end of that table. So I think the total system mass of this, including the nitrogen, and including the propellant to run the burner itself, the heat exchanger, so it will sum up to something like 100 kilos on that order. Whereas the BPM-5 way with expensive gas tanks, that would end up in something like, I think it's 300 kilos or 350. So we're saving money mm. by not buying these expensive tanks, and we're also saving roughly 200 kilos of mass.
And then we have to pay it back in complexity and
exactly.
learning some new interesting stuff, but I guess that'll work out fine.
Yeah, so that's part of the traveling or the process to learn some new stuff. So it'll be very exciting.
Mm. So of course it's been after the Nexo 2 launch, it's been quiet, and when you are into rocketry, I mean, you kind of get restless when you haven't seen lots of fire and flames for a while. So what's the next plan with lighting something?
So that will be the burner for the heat exchanger, and so that will be a test of how it burns, and also be a test of the new ignition system.
So ignitions. There's another one. There's the Easter egg.
So we normally light our engines with a pyrotechnic device, and we just shove it into the in through the nozzle, and it sits inside the propellant combustion chamber.
Good old fashioned Russian broomstick solution.
Yeah. Hmm. With the current design of the heater device, it's not so readily available to actually put in a pyrotechnic device. So it would be a lot easier if we can simply ignite it with a spark plug device.
But so, not any kind of spark plug, I guess.
No, it's going to be like a high power type of spark plug with a bit of special electronics to deliver a high pulse. So mm. we have some sort of a pretty big capacitor to supply a lot of energy. But that's a tentative plan to try and ignite it with a spark plug, mm. which will be a new thing for us. And so we're going to run it from the BPM5 test stand and also test out this spark plug igniter.
And then, of course, the work on that drop-in replacement injector for the BPM5, that's running in parallel. And, well, I guess if we can, if everything fits together, we can try and hot fire test that one somewhat not long after we tried the gasifier.
Yeah, so I would expect we could hot fire that maybe a month later or something.
Okay.
The BPM5 version. And from then on, then it will be a much faster road to actually having a BPM100 engine.
No, and hopefully a better chance of getting it right the first time.
Exactly. So I mean, we're not going to make the 100 days. With all these minor projects in between, we're definitely not going to make the 100 days. But we, I think by doing it this way, we are going to optimize the chance of getting it right the first time, or at least getting it so right that it doesn't just blow up in a big hole.
All right. That sounds like a solid plan, at least. Yeah, well, that's I guess, is the a lot of the different things that are stirring around, at least on the purely rocket-related part of what's going on right now. But there has also been a winter break here at CES. And we've also been looking into doing something new because, again, as you mentioned yourself, Spica is a very big rocket, and we have to do things differently.
Yeah. So in the workshop, what we have been doing for some weeks now is we've been upgrading a few things in the workshop. So most predominantly, we have an almost finished plasma cutting system. So on the Spica rocket, there will be a lot of need for water jet cutting, or I mean cutting metal, sheet metal, both for manufacturing the engine, but also for manufacturing the Spica itself. So we're building a plasma cutting setup for that. So it's huge, takes plates 4 by 2 meters or
4 by 2 when it's done. Yeah.
So it's huge and progress is nice. We got most of the parts for it now. And the guys are working on it right now, and it's going to be super interesting to see that light up for the first time.
Yeah, we're hoping to be able to do nearly all the parts that we need for the Spica rocket and do it in house, and especially for the upcoming work on building the first prototype propellant tanks. It's like 1,200 liter tanks. They're going to be huge. But this machine is going to help us in making all the different parts so that we have to just focus on more or less just welding the whole thing together. So that one is also upcoming, and we're hoping to do the first trial runs in about a month's time. So we're pretty far along with it.
Yeah.
All right, that's been a pretty long list of very interesting projects. So we haven't just been hibernating here at CS. We've been plenty busy since we had Nexo2 coming down nicely in a parachute. So stay with us and see what all of these interesting rocket projects end up becoming here in the spring of 19. CS is doing rocketry at a shoestring budget. It's laughable compared to the established business. And we are immensely thankful for all you supporters that help us make this possible. So please keep on donating. Please donate to CopsUp. And if you know anyone, maybe even a business that might think this is a crazy and cool project that you can get in on it, try them as well. The Spica project is huge, and you guys are the ones helping us realizing it.